Hi, I'm Samantha Sarin, a Board Certified Behavior Analyst with Brett DiNovi Associates, and we're going to be talking about ethical considerations for interdisciplinary collaboration with prescribing professionals. Regardless of how long you've been working in the field as a behavior analyst, chances are that you've probably worked with a client that's prescribed psychiatric medications. Various studies indicate that the percentage of individuals with autism who are prescribed psychiatric medications is around 29 to 34%. In other words, one out of every three learners that we work with is probably taking a psychiatric medication. One of the reasons that this collaboration with prescribing professionals is so important is because we have to consider medication as, of course, an intervention. And we know that anytime we introduce or modify or discontinue an intervention, that it's important to consider how that intervention can potentially affect other interventions that are already in place. So if we're looking at adding a medication, how does that impact what else we're doing with overall programming? Or if we're looking at changing or discontinuing a medication, we have to ask the same kind of question. And it's important to have those kinds of discussions with the prescribing professional so that we're able to better isolate which intervention is having potentially which effect. With that said, let's talk about our role as behavior analysts when collaborating with prescribing professionals. I'm going to provide three tips for successful collaboration. First one is to educate yourself. Understand that medications are prescribed for symptoms, not to cure a condition. In other words, a medication may be prescribed to help manage irritability due to autism, not to cure autism. Or a medication may be prescribed to help to increase ability to focus, not to cure attention deficit hyperactivity disorder. The FDA currently only has two approved antipsychotics that are prescribed for the treatment of the symptom of irritability associated with autism. So familiarize yourself with common classes of medications, such as sleep medications, psychostimulants, antipsychotics, and antidepressants, as those classes are the most commonly prescribed for our individuals with autism. Also, if you're able to learn some of the expected associated side effects, this can be especially useful when it comes to how we may be able to help as far as monitoring a symptom or taking data on a targeted behavior once a medication is prescribed or changed moving forward. All right, tip two, seek the expertise of a prescribing professional. From 3.02 medical consultation in the BACB's Professional and Ethical Compliance Code for Behavior Analysts, behavior analysts recommend seeking a medical consultation if there is any reasonable possibility that a referred behavior is influenced by medical or biological variables. In other words, we might look for the expertise of a psychiatrist when we've identified that a challenging behavior has an automatic function, since this would indicate that something internally regulated is reinforcing that challenging behavior. And the third tip, stay in your lane. So from 1.02, Boundaries of Competence in the BACB Professional and Ethical Compliance Code for Behavior Analysts, all behavior analysts provide services, teach, and conduct research only within the boundaries of their competence, defined as being commensurate with their education, training, and supervised experience. Basically, this means that behavior analysts collaborating with prescribing professionals are not doing things like suggesting which medication be prescribed. That would be far beyond our scope of competence. But what we can absolutely do is offer to take data on a targeted behavior or symptom, or even on a particular side effect, and we can of course summarize and present that data in a concise and meaningful way.
There's not a lot of research on the direct comparison of using only medication versus only ABA versus the combination of both. There are studies that compare medications to placebos, to cognitive behavioral therapy, and then to the combination. Because cognitive behavioral therapy, or CBT, often contains components of ABA, we should consider this research. What those studies show is that participants usually have the greatest effects from combination treatments, meaning both medication and CBT, in the earliest stages of treatment. Those differences sort of taper off the further that treatment continues, or the longer that treatment continues, so that there's not really significant differences noted in later stages of treatment. If we're going to look at studies that look at only medication for autism, there is some evidence for risperidone and aripiprazole decreasing challenging and repetitive behaviors associated with autism. Those are just two psychiatric medications, and we're talking about behavior reduction. In contrast, we know there's a wide body of research supporting sustained improvements for symptoms of autism using applied behavior analysis as the treatment. And with ABA, we're of course talking about targeting behavior reduction, but also skill acquisition.
If you'd like to hear more on other clinical topics like this, or are interested in further spreading the science, please click the link below to subscribe.